We now come to the very nadir of the Holocaust, the death camps, which, as we mentioned earlier, is a translation of the term Vernichtungslager, or destruction camps, literally making into nothing camps, which are distinguished from the so-called concentration camps, which were brutal, and people died in them, but primarily of abuse such as malnutrition and overwork. In the death camps, by contrast, the people who were sent here, Jews and non-Jews, were simply processed for death. A small number were set aside for slave labor or other purposes, but the vast majority of them were simply brought to these factories in order to deprive them of all their natural resources, everything from their clothing, their glasses, their prosthetic limbs, their gold teeth, and ultimately even their hair and their life. That's what makes the death camp so distinct in the history of human warfare, is that this is really the first time that a modern state uses its bureaucratic might and its modern industrial technology in order to affect the cause of destruction, of death of human life. Something truly incomprehensible. And unfortunately, it has set a precedent which is likely to reverberate throughout human history for the rest of time. This map indicates the major shift in priority of the Nazis from mobile killing squads, as we saw in the Einsatzgruppen, which brought the murder to the Jews and other populations, with the establishment of the death camps, first experimentally in the fall of 1941, and then in a much more significant manner from the spring of 1942 on, the victims were brought to the death camps rather than the other way around. As you can see, there are six camps which are specifically identified as death camps. Several other camps would later be retrofitted to absorb the kind of functions of the death camps, including, for example, Dachau and Mauthausen, which we'll see shortly. The major differences in structure are the location of nearby facilities for transport, like railway lines, the creation of gas chambers, and crematoria for ridding the Nazis of the evidence of the bodies. But this map gives you an indication of how the death camps acted as a kind of a geographic black hole that would draw in the Jews through the Nazi rail lines to their deaths in Eastern Europe. The first stage in the process was so-called selection, where the Jews would be disembarked from cattle cars. Many corpses would be left behind on these frequently brutal, long train rides, in which sometimes they were so crowded that they could not even sit down properly, without any sanitation and very little ventilation or food or water. But the survivors would be disembarked and then would be processed in a line where they would have to pass by some Nazi officers. They would either signal them to move to the left, which indicated that they would be processed immediately for death, or to the right, where they would be selected for other purposes such as slave labor or medical experimentation. On occasion, some of the camps, like Treblinka, would make good use of sort of decoy techniques, such as the presence of a live orchestra made up of prisoners that would play lively music or concertos for the Jews as they were disembarking, in order to try and assuage their concerns that they were about to meet an uncertain fate. And the Jews were largely compliant with this process. We will discuss in the next unit instances of resistance, but for the most part, the process went very well from a Nazi point of view. Those who were selected for death would be disrobed. Their hair would be shorn. They would typically be given shifts of uniforms that would only be worn for a very short period of time as they were marched to the gas chambers. In some cases, they were given towels and even soap to suggest that they were going for a regular shower or a de-lousing, when in reality they were going to their deaths. Their deaths would typically take place in a room which would later be filled with the noxious gases of a pesticide known as Ciclon B. This is the interior of the gas chamber at Majdanek. In some places, the gas chambers were actually built underground. In other places, they were retrofitted into barns or other types of structures. And the most important thing from the point of view of the operation was that they could be easily vented after the Jews inside or other prisoners were killed, and then their bodies could be removed for the next processing. Here is a photograph also from Majdanek that shows the vent on the roof where the Ciclon B capsules would be dropped. In some cases, the gas chambers actually had to be heated so that the pellets would transform into a gas once they hit the warmer atmosphere. And then the final destination would be the ovens. The bodies were removed by other prisoners called Sonderkommando, or special commando squads. The prisoners would take out the dead bodies and bring them to these crematoria, which would operate day and night to try and rid the camp of the remains of the victims. This photograph is from Mauthausen. You can see that someone has lit memorial candles in the openings of them, and there are other insignia from Austria and so on. The crematoria were notoriously unreliable, constantly breaking down, and quite often the bodies simply had to be burned out in the yard, as we see here in a clandestine photograph from the period. As I mentioned earlier, not everyone is immediately selected for processing to death. A small percentage were set aside for slave labor. They are housed in barracks like these here in Mauthausen. The street, by the way, is paved partially with the ashes of the victims that are killed in the gas chambers and then burned in the crematoria at Mauthausen, living under incredibly horrific circumstances of overcrowding, lack of sanitation, given a subsistence diet which is primarily liquid in nature and makes the prisoners prone to diarrhea, very debilitating dysentery that dehydrates them. But the idea of the Nazis were that this slave labor was, you know, highly replaceable, and it was easier to simply maltreat them and use them up until they expired. And in fact, the literature from the camps describes the slow and steady decline of the prisoners until they reached kind of like a walking zombie stage. In the camp rhetoric referred to these people as Müsselmänner, which is literally translated from German Muslims. It's a derogatory term, but it's intended to refer to these Jews and other prisoners who have so lost their sense of self that they can no longer maintain the self-respect to even, you know, comport themselves with normal conversation and so on. The Nazis actually tattooed numbers onto their arms, and it was forbidden to refer to another prisoner other than by their number. They literally dehumanized them, making them into commodities by giving them numbers. The great writer Primo Levi has written about this in a very moving manner. All told, the treatment of the slave laborers who were working in a variety of factories and satellite camps around the main camp has been described by the historian Terence Despres as an excremental assault. The Nazis actually pushed the camp prisoners back along the progress of human socialization, taking away every aspect of their individual identities, first their clothing, then their hair, then their names, and then even taking them through the childish stages to infancy, making it even impossible for them to prevent themselves from being soiled by their own waste. And this literal excremental assault wreaked havoc on their self-identity, their self-esteem, and ultimately led to their abandonment of normal self-respect. We'll have more to say about this in the next unit on resistance. Prisoners were also clearly marked by their status in the camp. You can see towards the bottom of this chart Various types of Jewish designations were given to them, attached to their clothing. The Star of David always indicated Jew, but depending on the combination of colors, they could be there also as political prisoners or as criminals or as even Jehovah's Witnesses Jewish or as homosexual Jews, the pink triangle. Designation of the reason why a person was imprisoned in the camps was extremely important to the social hierarchy there, because the Nazis would draw on the local population to police itself, promoting certain members of the camp, typically from the criminal population, to a higher level as so-called capos, and they would receive privileged access to food and rest and work duties and so on. The scenes at the time of liberation give us a glimpse at how badly treated the slave laborers were. Most of them only survived a few months before expiring, and the ones who managed to make it to the very end of the war tended to be those Jews and other prisoners who were sent to the camps at the very end of the war, Hungarian Jewry in particular. But you can see from the images of these young men how emaciated they are from the brutal treatment they've received as slave laborers. Finally, the Nazis used the slaves in the camps for infamous levels of medical experimentation on human beings. Shown on the left here is a photograph of children who were each part of a pair of twins. The Nazis were especially interested in identifying twins because then they could experiment on one partner of the pair and keep the other one set aside as a control. And so they engaged in all kinds of horrific experiments, removing lymph nodes and injecting chemicals and forced sterilization, all in an attempt to try to understand in a very primitive and crude and cruel manner the efficacy of their eugenics theories to build a master race. One of the most notorious of the criminals in this area is the man pictured at center here, Josef Mengele of Auschwitz, who was especially fond of working with children to try and determine how he could best improve the Nazi master race by experimenting on them. The Nazis also engaged in a wide variety of experiments that were associated with the war effort. One of the issues they had, for example, was Luftwaffe pilots being shot down over the Baltic Sea and freezing to death before they could be rescued. And so they experimented by dressing Jews in various suits and then immersing them in ice water for periods of time to see how they would survive the experience. Very cruel types of medical experimentation, which leaves open a major ethical question. What do we do with the meticulous records that have remained behind from these horrific and highly unethical experiments? We'll continue this series with a discussion of resistance to Nazism, both in the death camps and on a broader perspective as well. Thank you for watching.